Galapagos, the world-renowned island group off the west coast of Ecuador. The archipelago was made famous by Charles Darwin, but the mainland of this Latin American state is also well worth our visit. Our journey takes us through the moving history of the ancient Inca and the Spanish conquistadores. The Ecuador of today was once the northern province of the Inca kingdom. It was conquered by the Spanish in 1533. Ecuador gained independence in 1830. Today, the population is a colorful combination of descendants of ancient indigenous peoples, imported slaves, and immigrants from Europe. Half the population is mestizo, a mixture of white and Indian blood. About 39% are pure Indian. The rest are descendants of former African slaves or the offspring of the union of black and European couples. The gap between rich and poor is very broad in Ecuador. While the farmers in the Andes Mountains struggle to live on the little the land provides, majestic churches dominate the cityscape of the capital city of Quito. One of them is even completely plated with the purest of gold. Ecuador is named for the equator. It separates the land into a northern and southern section. The Andes mountain range divides the country into western Amazonia and the eastern part with its fascinating coastline and the Galapagos Islands. La mitad del mundo, the middle of the world, is the name of the equator monument. A symbolic globe of the earth sits enthroned 30 meters up in the air. Here, in 1736, Francesco Charles Marie de la Condamine established the location of the equator and marked it with a line. Today, tourists stream to this monument to have pictures taken standing on the middle of the earth. According to GPS satellite measurements, however, the true equator is about 200 meters further to the north. The western part of Ecuador is covered by thick rainforest. It is part of the gigantic Amazon rainforest, which stretches far beyond the border of Ecuador and continues all the way into Brazil. The exploration of the impenetrable leafy crowns of the trees has really only just begun. Biologists anticipate finding numerous yet unknown types of plants and animals. A few types of butterfly will probably be among them. During the time of metamorphosis from caterpillar to flying insect, the cocoon provided life-saving protection. Now it is just in the way. This hatching process is a risky business. Until the butterfly's wings are dry and firm, the insect cannot fly and is completely vulnerable. It doesn't stand a chance against this predatory wasp. Even if they survive the attacks of their predators, butterflies live only a short time, a few weeks or months at the most. They use their short time on Earth for one main purpose, to propagate. They feed on nectar and minerals from the riverbed. Our journey takes us deeper into the rainforest. It is a mystical and dangerous world. Only smaller prey is endangered by the alligator lurking close to shore. The anaconda is a different story. Among the largest snakes on Earth, the anaconda can grow to be up to 9 meters long. This one is just shedding its skin. The giant snake lays its scaly armor aside at regular intervals as it continues to grow. The process can take days. As hostile as the Ecuadorian rainforest might seem, it is inhabited. The Shuar Indians, for example, live as half nomads in scattered villages. The contrast between modern civilization and this primitive lifestyle is enormous. The father, Jose, for example, is the tribe shaman, or medicine man, while his daughter, Gemalinda, studies at the university in the capital city of Quito. Besides plantains, a type of cooking banana, the rainforest Indians live mainly on manioc and beer brewed from manioc. The work distribution between the genders is interesting. The cooking, for example, is done by the women. Weaving textiles and hunting is men's work. When Jose goes out in search of medicinal plants, he puts on the traditional Shuar feather headdress in order to appease the spirits. Talisman chains provide him with added protection. The Shuar believe that sickness and death are caused by unseen arrows shot at them by the spirits of the rainforest. As the shaman, Jose knows exactly which plants can be used at what time. Some plants can have healing properties one day and on the next have just the opposite effect. But the medicinal properties of the plant itself play only a secondary role in the shaman's home medicine practice. The spirits are the ones doing the healing. So the use of natural medicines in the tropical lowlands, for example, is limited to mind-altering drugs. In the highlands, thistles and a few other herbs are used. For the modern Ecuadorian, the relationship between a medical doctor and a shaman is a simple matter. The medical doctor fights symptoms, but by means of his rituals, the shaman goes deep into the spirit of the patient and deals with the deeper causes. After dark, traditional Shuar music provides entertainment and strengthens the bonds that unite the large family. The songs often tell stories about brave men courting honorable young virgins. They manage to outwit the spirits of the forest, and the lovers finally find one another. A new morning in the rainforest. The sun is the driving force which makes the lush plant growth possible in the first place. The red-eyed tree frog wakes up in his bed. He spent the night here and survived, thanks to his perfect camouflage. Now he is on the hunt for food. The ants would have made a nutritious breakfast, but they are extremely defensive and their bite is very painful. A female three-toed sloth lives in the neighborhood with her young. After a six-month pregnancy, the mother raises a little one on her own. The male doesn't bother with the offspring at all. A squirrel monkey enjoying a meal. This proves that having small hands can be a real advantage. The small monkey is safe from most predators up here in the tree. It looks different on the ground. Danger lurks all over the place. The boa constrictor follows the scent of its prey or lurks in the underbrush. If the prey becomes careless, the snake strikes with lightning speed. The squirrel monkey seems to be totally unaware of the imminent danger. He would make a nice little snack for the giant snake. You got lucky, little friend. The rustling of the dry leaves gave the snake away. He will surely get over it. We are back in civilization, but even here, man lives from nature. It provides the Ecuadorians with numerous raw materials that they can then process. These are toquilla leaves from a type of palm plant with fan-like leaves. Originating from the rainforest, these plants are cultivated on large plantations today. Further processing is still done by hand. The plant fibers need to dry for a few days before the next step can be taken. The experience and fine skills of this craftswoman turns the raw fibers into a hat, the famous Panama hat. The macrame is just the first step in taking the fiber through to the finished head covering. When the mesh is finished, it is pressed into form under high pressure in a steam press. Within a matter of minutes, the hat is finished. Its timeless elegance and comfort of wear have made the Panama hat a coveted fashion item all over the world. This hat has adorned many famous heads, among them world-renowned authors and other artists. And speaking of art, the artist studio of Edgardo Vega overlooks the rooftops of the city of Cuenca. Ed is one of the most famous of Ecuador's artists. His works are of national significance. His designs are intuitive, and he draws them freehand. His expressions reflect the special characteristics of the region, like hat weaving, for example. The artwork he produces is offered for sale in the adjoining small shop. In comparison to the mountains of Ecuador, living in the hills high above the city is merely like standing on tiptoe. The temperature change from the flatlands below causes the rising warm air to condense and form clouds of fog. The Cayas National Park lies at this altitude, a good 30 kilometers west of Cuenca. Thanks to the high humidity, lush vegetation abounds. But the trees grow very slowly this high up. It almost seems like the lichens and moss on the bark of the branches grows more quickly than the trees themselves, threatening to smother them. A herd of llamas has made this high altitude range their permanent home. They are generally known as beasts of burden and a source of wool, but llama meat is also very popular. Today, the llama herd in the Cayas National Park roams about as if it were an original part of the indigenous animal population. In fact, however, they are immigrants. According to the most recent scientific studies, dramatic climate changes in Earth's ancient past force the animals to migrate from North America to the South American continent. Female llamas reach maturity within 12 months and begin to produce offspring. The males, on the other hand, begin their role in propagation at an age of about 3 years. An attempt at mating? Looks deceive. Llamas mate while the female lies on the ground. That is a fairly unusual behavior for such large animals. Llamas were kept as pets already by the ancient Incas, just as it is today in Ingapirca, a former government outpost of the Indian Imperium north of Cuenca. The Canari lived here even before the Incas. After the Incan conquest, the two peoples lived together in peace. The grand festival, La Mama Negra, does not go back to the Incas. Two legends compete for its origin. The first one claims that prayers to this Virgin of the Merced stopped the eruption of the Cotopaxi volcano in 1742. Since that time, she has been referred to as the Queen of the Volcano. Another legend tells of a slave ship from Africa sinking just off the coast. Only a handful of slaves survived the shipwreck and escaped into the interior. One of the female slaves is said to have paid homage to the celebration. Various dance groups and marching bands perform in the procession. There seem to be no rules except to have a good time. And in accordance with ancient shaman tradition, visitors to the celebration are spiritually cleansed. Only the spirits know whether the Ecuadorians' colorful celebration really protects them from the angry outbursts of the land's many volcanoes. But there is good reason for the fear of eruptions. Nowhere else on our planet are there as many large active volcanoes to be found as there are between Cuenca and Otavalo. 20 active volcanoes are lined up one after the other over a stretch of only 250 kilometers. The highest of these unpredictable time bombs of nature is the Cotopaxi. It rises 5,897 meters above sea level. The Hacienda La Quinega is right at its foot. Today, the antique estate, with all of its original charm and much of its original furnishings, is a hotel. A famous German, Alexander von Humboldt, dined here about two centuries ago. The farmers in the Andes never lived in the noble manner Humboldt did. They have adapted very well to life in Ecuador's mountainous regions and still live very simply today. You see, nothing much grows anymore at an altitude of 3,600 meters. The onions grow very slowly, but for that, they develop an intense flavor. They are sold at the local markets in the valley. Every two or three days, the mountain farmers make the difficult journey down to the valley. That is about the length of time the onions stay fresh. The huts provide shelter for the husband and wife, and often five or more children. The walls are made of the clay found in the surrounding soil. Wood is rare up here, so to have at least a bit of warmth, the families heat their huts with dried grass. The farmers are taking a big risk by burning straw. The same material is used as insulation and could easily ignite as well. But in the end, warmth is more important than a safe fireplace. Along with other utensils of daily life, dried meat is hung in the rafters, filled with smoke from the open fire. The rugged lifestyle of the Andes farmers is reflected in their diet. Often, what little they have is stretched to make a soup. The cute little guinea pig is not a pet. With others of its kind, it is being raised for food. The animals have been bred for size and weight just for that purpose. They are considered to be a delicacy in Ecuador. Okay. The landscape up here is barren and forbidding, but for the Andes farmers, this is home. They have been working the fields and feeding their families with their crops for many generations. But there is something special about the landscape up here as well, almost as if it were a daydream. But the daydream could quickly turn into a nightmare. Looking into the peaceful waters of this lake, called Cuicocha in the Incan language, or Guinea Pig Lake, is actually looking into the collapsed lava chamber of a volcano that is still active. Our journey takes us to the ocean, where we follow the Costa del Sol, the coast of the sun. The Isla de la Plata, or Silver Island, is just a short hour's boat ride off the coast. If you were to think that a large silver deposit or even a treasure is behind the name, you would be wrong. It only describes the silver-white bird droppings that nesting seagulls leave behind. This female blue-footed booby has been nesting for over a month. Her first chick has already hatched. The blue-footed booby gets its name from its blue feet. The name booby was given because of the bird's clumsiness on the ground. But they are not the only ones who breed on Silver Island. A colony of frigate birds has occupied the trees right next door. The food collected on the open sea for the young is stored in the bird's gullet and regurgitated to feed their offspring. Their relatives on the coast have discovered that the fishermen load their fresh catch into waiting trucks every day. Of course, that means easy prey. The harbor city of Guayaquil. It was founded in 1538, and with its population of 3.5 million people, it is Ecuador's largest city. There is a small park in the center of the city. It is dedicated to Simon Bolivar, the South American freedom fighter. The city's inhabitants find a bit of rest and relaxation in the park, but they are not the only ones. A colony of green iguanas has taken up residency in this human recreational space. Iguanas are very common on the American continent. Their habitat stretches from the southern part of North America down to the Galapagos Islands. Depending on the subspecies, these lizards can grow to be up to 2 meters long. Scientists categorize these dragon-like creatures among the land vertebrates. They live mostly on the ground, in trees, or in rocky crags. The males are territorial in nature and stubbornly defend their territory against all rivals. Only females are allowed to trespass unchallenged. After all, the love of his life might be among them. To start with, young lizards feed on insects and other small animals. As they grow older, they complement their diet with more and more plant matter. The iguanas are not the only animals in the park. The squirrel, for example, has learned a long time ago that it has nothing to fear from the lizards. In spite of their archaic appearance, these small green dragons are total vegetarians. And they are very laid back. Every day, the park employees feed them fresh lettuce. And the free meals seem to be the only things that get them moving. Visitors are fascinated by the unusually approachable lizards. They take photos, and every once in a while, the iguanas even come up to get petted. When it gets to be too much, or their hunger is satisfied, the animals simply retreat into the trees. Not all of Ecuador's lizards live so comfortably, but certainly more naturally. On the Galapagos Islands, for example. The archipelago lies about 1,000 kilometers off the coast to the west. To the delight of those traveling by boat, dolphins often escort approaching sea craft. The Galapagos are volcanic in origin and consist of 13 main and about 110 smaller islands. The Portuguese discovered this natural paradise by accident in 1537 when their ship veered off course on the way from Panama to Peru. Meager vegetation over most of the year and the dry climate are considered to be reasons why these islands were not settled by humans sooner. So the island's plant life, and particularly its animals, were virtually undisturbed by human civilization until relatively recently. Ever since a whaling ship began using the Galapagos as a hunting base at the beginning of the 19th century, the islands have been partially inhabited. Today, road signs warn motorists to take care. The lizards have the right of way here. This is a Galapagos marine iguana. It is endemic, a unique species, and indigenous only to the Galapagos. It stays close to the ocean, and that for a very specific reason. It feeds on algae which grow in the surf zone where the waves wash over the rocks. The algae survive here even during extended periods of drought. The moist algae also serve as a source of fresh water for the marine iguana. The lizard separates and expels unwanted salt via glands on its nose. The lizard is not bothered by the surf along the rocky coast, even when it gets violent. Unimpressed by the foaming breakers and the undertow, it dives to the bottom and enjoys a meal of algae on the rocks. Thank you. Marine iguanas can dive to depths of about 15 meters and remain underwater for as much as half an hour. The grazing iguanas are often disturbed by Galapagos seals. They are not actually on the predator's menu, but out in the wilderness, who can you trust? As cold-blooded reptiles, the lizards have to return to land regularly and let the sun restore the body temperature lost in the cool waters. Over untold ages, the lizards have gotten used to living with no natural enemies. But in spite of that, the animals have been placed on the endangered species list. And the reason is man. Stray dogs and cats brought to the islands by man make life difficult for the iguanas. The population of marine iguanas is particularly sensitive to the El Niño weather phenomenon. The increase in water temperature and rise of the sea level during such periods causes the sea algae to be overgrown. This caused every second lizard to starve to death during the El Niño of the century in the 1980s. The isolation of the islands over countless years has resulted in various species developing within the same kind on the Galapagos. A good example is the Galapagos giant tortoise. The various subspecies living on the different islands all share the same ancestors. They all belong to the same kind, or family, of giant tortoise, but have adapted to the diverse living environments on their corresponding island. It was Charles Darwin, during his scientific expedition to the Galapagos Islands, who first suspected a relationship between the types or kinds of animals. He concluded that adaptations to prevailing climate and living conditions could lead to the development of specialized subgroups of the same species. Kinds that do not adapt die out. Shortly thereafter, he formulated his theory of evolution of species through natural selection. The Galapagos giant tortoise is a voracious vegetarian. It will eat any kind of plant, including grasses, herbs, bushes, berries, lichens, and cactus. But to get to the lush vegetation, they must make their way from the dry coastal regions up to the volcanic highlands of the islands, along paths that have been established for generations. That is the only place with sufficient water and the diverse vegetation they need for a balanced nutrition. The curve of the shell reveals the animal's feeding preference, whether more grasses or bushes, for example. Tortoises which feed primarily on bushes and opuntia, a type of fig cactus, have developed a saddle-shaped shell that enables them to stretch their necks farther to reach the high-hanging vegetation. The islands offer the turtles about 700 types of plant, most of them growing at altitudes starting at about 150 meters above sea level. The menu includes everything from coral trees through Galapagos passion flowers to mistletoe and thistles. Animals with a dome-shaped shell prefer ground plants. The finch family, described by Darwin, consists of at least 14 kinds. According to his theory, they supposedly originated from a single finch kind that found its way to the island about 3 million years ago. Adaptations to the diverse nutrition available on the different islands resulted in specialization. They include the warbler finch, the mangrove Darwin finch, and the opuntia ground finch, which feeds on cactus. A Charles Darwin research station has been established on the island of Cruz. It has become an attraction for countless tourist groups. At the breeding station, attempts are being made to counteract the downward trend in the giant turtle population. The very thing that makes them so special, their diversity, is the thing that is endangering the populations. There are often too few animals left to revitalize the population. An entire subspecies died out as recently as 2011. Ecuador is putting enormous effort into preventing the loss of any more representative types of primeval animals. This country's rainforests, the highlands, and the Galapagos Islands are certainly among the last paradises on our planet.